Music of Motown. It arrived early in the decade when suddenly American teenagers, black and white, were singing and dancing to the same tunes. And nobody sang them better than Martha and the Vandellas. Martha Reeves was a Motown queen. She was pretty and sharp and sassy. She had it all. So who would have thought that her life was headed for disaster? Tonight, Martha Reeves tells Bob Brown her story of Motown, when everyone, it seemed, was dancing in the street.
What used to represent a way of life for 53-year-old Martha Reeves is now a museum in a working-class neighborhood of Detroit.
These are the marvelous.
The museum chronicles the rise of Motown Records, where, in the 1960s, Reeves was part of an extraordinary stable of young performers. Her contributions to the wealth, recorded with an oddly named group called the Vandellas, included classics like the 1963 hit, Heat Wave.
I wanted a name that stood for Detroit. So Van Dyke is the street that I lived near. Anyone from Detroit knows where Van Dyke Street is. And then Della Reese had impressed me greatly. I said, Della Reese. Maybe we can blend from some of her names, so we came up with Vandellas.
They helped create what was called the Motown sound, known for tight vocal harmonies, for using strings on songs with rhythm and blues pedigrees, and for heavy percussion, often with a Latin influence. Motown lyrics are almost always in the present tense, as if they'd just come off the street that day. Dancing in the Street, released in 1964, was a perfect example.
Our music is very difficult to sing. It's really hard to teach, you know, because you have to almost have the scale in your, imprinted in your mind to realize where they want you to sing your melodies and where the harmonies actually fit. And the little catchy rhythmic things that were done that were not easy.
In a book titled Dancing in the Street, Reeves has written an insider view of those early days and of the near disasters in her life when her journey as a Motown diva was over.
This is Studio A. And that was Studio B. That was basically where you did the overdubs and you had the echo chambers.
The studio and the company were built by an astute music entrepreneur, Berry Gordy Jr. The sound, by a small group of session musicians and songwriters. Smokey Robinson was behind a lot of the early music, and some of Martha Reeves' strongest material was supplied by one prolific songwriting team, Brian and Eddie Holland and Lamont Dozier. They wrote a novelty song called Come and Get These Memories that introduced Martha and the Vandellas on the first big Motown tour in 1962.
Here's that old teddy bear. Come and get it. That you won for me at the state fair.
Closely chaperoned under orders from Berry Gordy, the Motown artists left together by bus on that groundbreaking tour. Martha and the Vandellas, Marvin Gaye, Diana Ross and the Supremes, Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, Mary Wells, the Temptations, the Marvelettes, and Stevie Wonder, all performing on the same bill. And who can forget the look, from the suits to the wigs?
Now, they gave us wigs because our hair was hard to keep. So we put these wigs on and we try to sleep in them. You know, you wake up with one side mashed from riding all night, and we were learning how to do show business.
They were really learning just a part of show business. Reeves says she had no idea of the extent or management of the revenues that came in from her songs.
The money was being made and...
In your name.
And my name. And I wasn't handling it. I didn't know where it was going. I didn't know how it was being spent.
But you signed your tax return every year.
No, somebody gave that wasn't it to, necessary.
Somebody that else signed
contract
it for you?
That contract had that authority to go with it. I never had to worry about taxes. We didn't worry about anything but going on stage and singing. Like I say, they looked after our affairs.
In fact, that part of the Motown system was based on making the artists pay some of their own production costs by deducting those costs from the royalty payments the artists earned. It was legal, and since Motown also managed the artists through its own agency, there were no outside managers to challenge whether the policy was fair. The bottom line was that Motown prospered. By 1965, the company had become the country's most profitable independent recording company, grossing $8 million that year. It was a company that expected its artists to reflect that success. To improve their charm and poise and etiquette, Motown hired top-flight instructors.
When I asked Barry where the money was going, he was insulted. He was appalled. Why would I ask that? The money went for instructions. And it took all of our money collectively to give them a decent salary so they could work with us day in and day out, travel with us, nurture us, develop us to the talent that we've become.
But as the artists on Motown's roster became individual stars, competition started to develop. Reeves says her own position at Motown took a sharp turn for the worse just when her popularity was rising in 1965 and another Motown girl group was starting to get even more attention.
Was there bitterness between the two groups or between you and Diana Ross?
I didn't take it to her because I was happy for her. I imagine for Avis the hair did be a hurts, and I kind of feel that that's how we are as far as the Motown sound is concerned. We were kind of like the rough and ready, go and get them type performers, and the Supremes were pampered and put through a more of an easier way, I'll put it that way. And I'm all right with that.
At one time, though, she was furious. During an overseas Motown tour, she had been invited to appear on British TV by pop star Dusty Springfield. But Reeves says Berry Gordy worked to get better exposure on that show for the Supremes.
Did he tell you as much?
No, he told me. He had a plan for them, and they were on the top rung of the ladder, and he's going to have them in that spot and just do what I'm told, which is his prerogative. It's his company, his music. But here I'm in protest, because this is the first time that I felt betrayed. It was the first time that I'd ever been just directly told, this is the star of this show, you're not, step back.
She says her relationship with Motown began to unravel in 1968. By that time, she had compiled an album of greatest hits, adding songs like Nowhere to Run. But she was also getting a reputation as being difficult. And along with suffering her first nervous breakdown in 1969, she had developed a drug problem.
The hook is the gift. When you first get it, it's given to you. So they must really like me to give me that. That's some expensive stuff. They must, how stupid was I? And I'm not ashamed of it, because it's going to happen to a lot of people who want to be in show business, and I want to help them.
But it sounds
I didn't know about it.
It sounds like that goes beyond naivete, doesn't it? Shouldn't you have known?
I wanted to be in. When you do that, you're in. You get to meet prestigious people. You get called into places that you wouldn't normally get into if you're doing that. There's a situation where you're sitting down and someone will come up with something in a server. They want you to do this. So they walk real close to your face and they put something very close to your nose. I've been told that I had an ideal nose because it's kind of large. But if it's there in your face and you're afraid that if you knock it away and get irate about it, that you might have to have a confrontation. You don't spill that valuable stuff. It's expensive. It shines like diamonds. It's precious to some people. It's their lifeline. And they tie it in with show business. They'll tell you, in order to be a performer or a singer, you got to do this.
She says she accepted pills and street drugs from hangers-on and other musicians without even knowing what she was taking. She suffered another breakdown in 1971 and was taken to a mental institution. There, Martha Reeves, once so carefully trained and chaperoned, was locked in a padded cell after a confrontation with attendants that she says was touched off when she asked for medication.
I screamed and yelled for the first 15, 20 minutes and realized nobody was going to let me out, that I was actually Martha Reeves, was locked up in a padded cell. Wait till the newspaper gets wind of this. Look how that's going to read. And I remembered the padded cell and associated it with the little mats we used to play with. Play on in gym, where you climb the little hard rope and slide down and get skin burned and get your knees all scarred up, but tossing and tumbling on mats, that's what that reminded me of. I had to put myself in a better place than where I was. So I kind of removed myself and went back to my childhood, and I pretended that this padded cell was those mats I used to, it smelled the same, it felt the same. It was like those mats that I played with at gym.
Church bells ring.
Reeves settled back in Detroit in 1972, back to where she'd sung on the playground next to her school as a teenager. Over the years, she's kept her act going, but the women who've sung in pairs as the Vandellas have hung on to their day jobs as a main source of income. Annette Sterling on the left is a hospital technician. Rosalind Ashford works for Michigan Bell. Martha's sister Lois is a secretary with the Detroit Symphony, and her other sister Delphine, an executive with Blue Cross Blue Shield. Reeves' contractual relationships with Motown were severed 23 years ago. But ultimately, there was one last debt reckoning between Martha Reeves and Motown. In 1991, Berry Gordy settled for an undisclosed sum, a lawsuit she had filed seeking an accounting of royalties from her 1963 hit, Heatwave. The company did create one asset that has never stopped paying dividends, the Motown sound. Because of that, she's of two minds about what her past meant to her, about what she gained, and what she never got.
I had two feelings. First feeling was, why wasn't I informed? Why didn't I know better? And the second feeling was, isn't it wonderful how they kept all of that away from us and let us develop our talent?
Music. We should point out, Bob, that Berry Gordy, who almost never does interviews, I don't remember seeing him doing one, will be on with us later this fall. He's written his autobiography. His point of view is that his whole system, the whole Motown system, created these stars who might not have made it without everything that he and Motown put into them.
That's true, and they acknowledge that. They just say they wish they had been told more about how the revenues were accounted for and where the money was going. But Martha Reeves says she's not bitter, even though she settled a lawsuit with him, and many of the other people who have sued him have come out of it saying the very same thing, that they're not bitter about the results.
And the good thing is that she's still working and still doing okay.
She still makes a good living off the Motown sound, as we saw with the crowd she drew.